Welcome back, everyone. So I think we successfully managed to travel from a webinar to breakout session, then now back to the webinar. So I hope you enjoyed this intermission. That was such a nice, refreshing intermission. I hope you enjoyed the music as much as I did. And I wish we could have them live for a couple of sets later after the show. So if you want to know more about them, you can search for them. They're called the Talaundig tribe. So it has been mentioned in the chat also, and we can keep on sharing more information about them. It was really a nice music. I still have it in my head. It's really something that that I enjoy. I also hope that you guys enjoyed the breakout session. So you guys had a choice between the three sessions, like we mentioned earlier. Probably I can share some key takeaway with you on the zero exclusion, where the root cause of the systemic social exclusion in the Philippines is the failure of our society to recognize the basic human rights of the socially excluded population. It stems for the bigger population looking at the socially excluded as recipient of help versus being robbed of their natural resources, agencies, and the socially excluded population themselves, not embracing their identity. So we need a reset in our mindset, in our strategy, so we can move forward towards a more inclusive society for our country. So it was very exciting session, sorry. And if you did not have a chance to see it, we will post them on social media later on. We did record every session. When it comes to the zero carbon one, one of the key takeaways that was there is there's a lot of reasons why we should be worried today, but there is also so many reasons why we should remain hopeful. So let's treat this lockdown as an opportunity to reset our relationship with the environment. As our panelists pointed out, this is the time to rethink our previous lifestyle choices, stick with the essentials, support local, be part of the community that advocates for the betterment of our planet. And it starts today, and it's something that you really have to do every day. Then for the third one, the zero poverty session. So a lot of numbers, a lot of statistics. So you see the emergency, you need the urgency to act and to do something about it. And I guess one of the most pressuring issue is hunger. And I think today it's World Food Day. So it's such a timely moment to talk about hunger. And just about a few days ago, Gawatelinga organized an event where they were able to feed 36,000 kids all across the country. And we really need to continue, because every day there are 15 million people that do experience hunger just in the Philippines. So as much as this forum is really looking also at the medium-term action and at the long-term action, definitely there is a lot of urgency to address short-term goals on feeding the hungriest in this country. So exciting sessions. If you did not get to watch the two other sessions, I invite you to check on our Facebook page and to also reach out to the different panelists that were there in the session. Look up for them on social media, look up for them online, so you can get to know more about what they're doing. So moving on with our program, I would now like to start with the plenary too. So I would like to invite a broadcast journalist and the founder of Niña Inabel, Ms. Niña Corpus, to introduce our speakers for plenary two to talk about breaking barriers towards a 3.0 future. Take it away, Niña.
Thank you so much, Fabian. You know, my kids have your stuffed toys. Anyway, welcome everyone to Plenary 2 of 3.0 Forum 2020, Breaking Barrier Towards a Zero Future. I'm really honored to be here today and to introduce our amazing group of panelists. These are people who have challenged the status quo to pave the way for zero carbon, zero exclusion, and zero poverty. They will share with us their inspiring stories on how they persevered despite the challenges they faced in their roles or in their communities. You know, we had a dry run the other day, and let me just say that we are all so lucky to be here, because ang galing ng mga istorya nila at talagang dapat pakinggan at pag-usapan. Let me just remind everyone that you may ask your questions and write them in the chat box. We will read them after all of our four panelists have finished their presentations. Our first speaker is Ms. Mikey Kawanko Jaworski. She's the representative to the Philippines and executive board member to the International Olympic Committee, or IOC, Earth Hour Ambassador and Climate Change Solutions Steward for the World Wide Fund for Nature Philippines, or WWF, Gawad Kalinga Volunteer, spokesperson for Anak TV, Child Rights Ambassador for Plan International Philippines from 2008 to 2012. She's the president of the Equestrian Association of the Philippines, Philippine Sports Writer Association Sportswoman of the Year 2002, Parangal ng Bayan National Honor Award for Excellence in Sports 2003, Ateneo de Manila University Alumni Association Hall of Fame Citation for Excellence in Sports in 2003. She's the gold medalist for the jumping individual competition and silver medalist for the jumping team competition in the 2002 Busan Asian Games in Korea. Gold medalist in the team jumping competition at the 2005 Manila Southeast Asian Games representing the Philippines. Let's all welcome Ms. Mikey Kawanko Jaworski. Hi, Mikey.
Hi, Nina. Thanks for that introduction. Does it count towards my 15 minutes? Anyway, I'm not sure if you all can see me already. My video is on and I'm unmuted. So I'm not really sure what's happening right now.
Well, we can see you and we can hear you. So you can, oh,
okay,
you can
cool. Go ahead. Okay. So I'm going to ask Bert to start my presentation on the first page. And since I'm taking the controls, I'm gonna get right into it. So when I was asked to be part of an initiative to start a conversation that would lead to closer collaboration towards the shaping of the true normal, I knew I really couldn't say no. Well, that reason and Kuya Luis asking me to be a part of it, I'm really a big believer. Okay, I'm back. Can you all see me?
Yeah, we see you.
Okay, I don't have controls of my presentation now, so I'm just, okay. Sorry about these technical difficulties, but okay. I'm a big believer in us being pieces of a puzzle that will complete or be part of our journey towards reaching our goals. So let me talk about the different organizations that I'm a part of that I try to make my contribution in. I'm going to begin with the International Olympic Committee. So maybe you've heard about the IOC and maybe not, but if you look at the logo of the IOC, we know that it has something to do with the Olympic Games, but what really are we trying to do? So we are trying to build a better world through sport. The Olympic values are excellence, respect, and friendship. So we encourage people to go faster, higher, and stronger. Be excellent in everything that you do. Show respect for the rules, for each other, for your teammates, for your coaches, for everybody who was part of the game that we play, and friendship. When we come together at the Olympic Games, it doesn't matter where you're from. It doesn't matter how old you are, whether you're a man or a woman, you're all in the Olympic Village sharing that space and meeting each other and making friends. The mission of the International Olympic Committee is to ensure the uniqueness of the regular celebration of the Olympic Games. Every 4 years, we have the Summer Games, and in between that, interspersed every 4 years, we have the Winter Games. Now we also have the Youth Olympic Games, where we do a lot of educative events around values that you learn through sport. Excellence, friendship, respect, hard work, discipline, joy of effort, which is what Olympism is all about. Olympism is a philosophy of life. It places sport at the service of humankind. And my favorite part about Olympism is that it talks about us being happy, putting the work in. It's about us not thinking a sacrifice is a sacrifice because we just love what we do. Whether or not we have a medal, we know that we have achieved something as human beings because we have pushed ourselves to do so. So what are the working principles of the IOC? Universality and solidarity, unity and diversity, autonomy and good governance, and sustainability. So that's what I am hoping to focus on today. Next slide, please. So when I first became an IOC member, it was around the same, it was actually the same time that the current IOC president, President Thomas Bach, was elected into office. And we had decided to embark on Olympic Agenda 2020. We came together and put the goals of the IOC together. What did we want to be? What did we want to do? We went by the mantra, change or be changed. So the IOC having three spheres of responsibility. One, as an organization. Two, as the owner of the Olympic Games. And three, as the leader of the Olympic movement. So beyond that, we wanted to define what our responsibilities were. What could we influence in the sphere of sustainability? So we came up under the leadership of Prince Albert of Monaco, the IOC sustainability strategy. So aside from these three spheres, it includes infrastructure and natural sites, because when we organize the Olympic Games, we do end up with large structures, but a host doesn't even bid for the Olympic Games unless they are in tune, having the games are aligned with their city and nationwide development goals. Sourcing and resource management, obviously there is a lot of procurement involved, there is a lot of sourcing involved. Mobility, all the traveling that is done by an athlete to compete, by officials to officiate, and even us sports administrators. Workforce, dignity in the workplace, proper compensation, and helping each other be the best and do the best that we can be. And of course, there's also climate with all the things that we do as an Olympic movement. Next slide, please. As part of Olympic Agenda 2020, the IOC set out 18 objectives across these three spheres. So these were mainly the beginning of us taking a lot more seriously us ourselves as a sustainable organization and the influence that the IOC has on international federations and national Olympic committees. So, as it is 2020, we have assessed how we have fared in this. And I would say not so badly, considering that the IOC has built the Olympic House, which is, it won the Sustainability Award. It's a green building and architectural awards for being a sustainable structure. I won't go into the details in the interest of time, but I will say that we have also defined our 2030 strategic intent, where we would have already increased our impact and been a model of sustainability, not just for different organizations similar to the IOC, but also ranging over the 206 National Olympic Committees and the international federations that are part of the Olympic movement. Next slide, please. The SDGs. Having the SDGs as a guide and as a common goal is so helpful because it really leads us to a path where we can meet at some place, regardless of what we are trying to do, where we are coming from, what is our expertise. As far as sport is concerned, we really believe that sport contributes to social development health and well-being, quality education, gender equality, peace, justice, and strong institutions, and partnerships for sustainability. So all of this are examples of why sport is something that we encourage. It's something that we push. We really believe in the power of sport to unify. And we also believe that sport is a tool for character building, for nation building, and to teach individuals how we can be global citizens who contribute to the development of our nations and ourselves to be of service to our fellow man. Next slide, please. Sport has contributed largely in shaping the person that I am today. And I know that I am very blessed to have the opportunity to serve in the IOC as an executive board member and as the chairperson of the Education Commission. But I certainly remember a time when I asked myself, what could I do? Just me, just by myself. What could I possibly do that could help make an impact in this world? Next slide, please. So I was very young when the way that people treat the environment became an issue. In a webinar, which I moderated yesterday with the WWF, the Worldwide Fund for Nature, and the Department of Tourism of the Philippines, we talked about the three R's: reuse, reduce, and recycle. And I thought to myself, well, you know what? When I was a young person in high school, that's already what we were being told to do. And I recall a conversation I had not too long ago with a doctor from the WHO who said, well, at the moment, the best way to deal with COVID-19 is still to keep proper hygiene, social distancing, and wear your masks. The same thing that was done hundreds of years ago when there were pandemics that occurred. And I asked myself, these age-old solutions are still what are being pushed now, especially with the three R's: reuse, reduce, recycle. So have we not moved forward? But the thing is, sometimes it seems like you haven't even made enough ground in one area when another issue comes up. And there is a topic that has recently become very urgent to me, which is food waste. And as mentioned earlier, today is World Food Day. So it's just appropriate that we talk about food today. I'm not sure if we realize all the biological processes that have to happen for us to get food on the table, from growing, harvesting, processing, packaging, transporting, marketing, but it's true that our food system is the single biggest threat to nature today. It leads to 70% of biodiversity loss, and 93% of all our fish stocks are being fished to their limits or beyond. So in spite of all this, because the demand for food keeps growing and growing to the point that we are destroying our environment because we need to eat, we don't even finish all the food that comes to us as consumers. One third of food is lost in the supply chain or is thrown away. And we are putting impossible strain on our planet. Next slide, please. So from the farm to the fork, food is wasted at every step of the journey. And whether it's in the way it's stored before we buy it, or because we have to see best before dates and follow it so it doesn't make us ill, it's just sometimes as simple as not even having a proper container to put food in that it would spoil or be destroyed, or cooking too much, or whatever it is. Most uneaten food ends up in landfills. It rots, it releases greenhouse emissions. So wasted food contributes approximately 8% of all global emissions. Next slide, please. There are solutions at every scale, but we really have to think about how we can be practical and how we can be realistic, because we cannot compel government or other institutions to provide, especially at this stage, what it was not able to fulfill before. So being that, let's say, okay, let me just go through this slide for once. Source reduction is preventing food waste. Feeding the hungry people, which we know there are millions of in the world. We can donate food, but obviously we need to donate edible and sound food, not leftovers, not as an afterthought, but just knowing that there is so much need and realizing, assessing what we need and don't need. There's also food that needs to go to feeding the animals. There is food that can go to industrial use. And there is composting, which, yes, some effort, but completely doable regardless of where we are. Because all the food waste that doesn't go to any of those goes to landfill, incineration, greenhouse gases. The truth is, for the IOC and the WWF, this pandemic has pushed us to work harder and to work faster. The plans were already there. The path is still correct. It's not as if we did something wrong and now have to change everything we planned on. The urgency has just increased. But the truth is, if we want to talk about urgency, this is what we're going to have to talk about first. Next slide, please. Food waste is an extremely alarming issue because while there are 14.2 million undernourished and 13 million food insecure Filipinos, or that's nearly one third of the country's population, the world, including the Philippines, dumps 1.3 billion tons of food yearly. This much food can feed 2 billion people, or more than twice the number of undernourished individuals in the world. And today, there are too many people who are hungry. You know, I don't know how many of you have heard this term, hangry. It's when you become very irritable and get into a very bad mood when you're hungry, when you need to eat. What more can starvation do? How much can malnutrition take away from a whole generation, from a whole nation? And that's just speaking under normal circumstances. But what about now? What about now when people can't work? What about now when we are not probably getting the supply that we're used to having? So we might have these large organizations that are stable, that know what to do, that are working even at this point to anticipate what action we would jump right back into once this pandemic issue has been addressed. It's just impossible for us to turn a blind eye to one of humanity's most basic needs, which is nourishment. So, if a chain is only as strong as its weakest link, where is the hope? Next slide, please. So the one thing that COVID-19 has done is to put us all truly on the same boat. Not even climate change as an issue managed to do that, managed to make the earth and every human being focus on just that one issue and try to address it. COVID-19 exposed all the weaknesses in many, many systems, but it has also pushed, forced, inspired many to step up beyond their own expectations. And that's why today, being here brings hope and it brings inspiration. The work that many are doing today brings not only hope, even better, they bring answers. So I have on my slide here what Dawat Kalinga has been doing since 2014 and the Walang Iwanan Alliance, which aims to bring together everybody who has already been trying to share this gift of food with many people who are hungry, many people who need food but can't get it for themselves. If we are wondering what we can do, if this is something we want to do, these are organizations that have already made it easier for us to help and contribute in this way. It's not always about money. It's also about time. It's also about effort. And it's also about talent. But this is a wonderful opportunity as it provides an avenue for us to be good brothers and sisters to each other. You know, I'm usually a pragmatist, and I guess maybe I could be naive, but sometimes I'd like to think that barriers don't really exist. We just have to actually make the connections. So with that, I thank you all for this opportunity to share with you, and I am looking forward to hearing from our other speakers and likewise learning from them. There's nothing left to say but thank you, but there is a lot left to do, and thank God we have each other.
Thank you very much, Mikey, for that very inspiring presentation. Mikey talked about Olympism, the philosophy of the Olympic Games, and how it integrates sports with culture, education, and international cooperation. She also talked about the programs of the WWF for awareness and action on issues such as the degradation of nature, climate change, and food waste. And finally, she also talked about the effect of COVID-19 on the already huge problem of malnutrition, but it has at least provided more awareness and has made more people come together to offer solutions, such as with Gawad Kalinga in the Walang Iwanan Alliance. And I also like the part when you said, Mikey, that it's not always about money. There's also time, there's also effort and talent. And so that's why we're all here today. Thank you, Mikey. Later, we will be asking you questions. But for now, let us thank you. Let us move on. Thank you, Mikey, to Ms. Georgie Pantoja. She's the founder and CEO of Coffee for Peace. She's a woman entrepreneur winner of Citibank Business and Development Network Philippines in 2010. She also received in 2015 an NPS Award from the United Nations Development Program Impact Investment Exchange Asia in behalf of the women who comprise the 80% of the farmers of Coffee for Peace Incorporated. She earned a degree in international relations from the University of the Philippines and a graduate degree in Masters of Entrepreneurship and Social Enterprise Development from the Ateneo de Manila University Graduate School of Business. Coffee for Peace is a social enterprise that works with indigenous people and rural poor in the Philippines to promote economic empowerment, peace and reconciliation, and environmental stewardship. And most recently, Coffee for Peace won the Oslo Business for Peace Award 2020, which is like the Nobel Peace Prize for business. Let's all welcome Ms. Georgie Pantoja of Coffee for Peace.
Good afternoon. Can everybody
hear me? Hi, Ms. Georgie.
Hello.
Good afternoon. Yes, we can hear you. We can see you.
Okay. So I would like to talk about what we do as Coffee for Peace, and hope to share the slide. I don't know if my slides are showing now. But in the article, "The World's Most Popular Coffee is Growing Extinct," the scientists at Kew Royal Botanic Gardens in the United Kingdom state that 75 out of 124 wild coffee varieties are at risk for extinction due to climate change, deforestation, drought, and plant diseases. Senior researcher Aaron Davis said that the Arabica coffee, which is the most popular coffee for commercial production, would be extinct in 60 years. Some coffee species could be extinct in as little as 10 to 20 years. The reduction of the coffee gene pool could affect commercial production because fewer crops would mean more expensive and lesser quality coffee. Also, a diverse crop of wild coffee plant is needed to create genetically modified plants that can withstand climate change and pests. Furthermore, the scientists said that although there's a technology to preserve seeds, coffee is more difficult and expensive to store in the storage banks. Therefore, the key is to protect wild coffee's natural environment, which is in the forest habitat. In the next slide, Coffee for Peace strengthens our advocacy in addressing climate change because it's part of our values. As citizens of this world, we have to be mindful of what we do and how we treat our Mother Earth. Part of Coffee for Peace values, which is the meaning of peace to us, is harmony with your creator and its creation, and also harmony with ourselves and others. Climate change is also a peace and justice issue in which millions of Filipinos suffer from its impact, particularly those brought by super typhoons like El Nino and La Nina phenomena. In the next slide, you would see that it's not just the coffee processing from seed to cup that we are doing, but we are involved from farm to the shop, to the coffee shop. Right now, we use a Penagos coffee pulper, which uses 80% less water than the traditional pulping machine. We also encourage our farmers to have their farm GAP certified and to plant more indigenous forest trees because Arabica coffee tastes better under shade trees. We started in 2006, and when we meet with the community, we listen to their dreams. We ask them on how they think they could achieve their dreams. Working with 880 farmers all over the Philippines, from Kalinga to Sarangani province, we have witnessed many farming families and communities improve their living condition, improved their confidence level to negotiate with their own buyers, and is now implementing their dreams. Now Coffee for Peace is not alone. We have other farmers who are teaching others and have become farmerpreneurs. In the next slide, you would see a road that was broken and a house being built. The tribal communities are the most affected group of people when the mountains are deforested because they are the natural dwellers of the land. One example before COVID from October 2019 to December 2019 here in Mindanao, we have experienced several earthquakes in the area of Mount Apo. This posed a setback on the development that is happening in the area. The Bagobo Tagabawa and the Ata Manobo are some of the affected tribal communities in Mount Apo. In the 50s and 60s, Mount Apo was logged by big logging corporations. because of the intensive forest denudation, the village in the lower part of the mountain bear the brunt of floods and landslide during rainy season. Then, lack of water during the summer season. This, as well as lack of economic opportunities, severely affected their living condition. Discrimination also play a huge part in the slow erosion of their culture as the younger generation faced shame for their identity. By facilitating to restore the dignity they have lost and making them active leaders in the economic stimulation in their area, they are the ones who will take care of our forest. Coffee for Peace is just one of the many social enterprises that joins the world to contribute in attaining our 17 Sustainable Development Goals. COVID slowed down the economic activities happening in the area. Under the new normal, they have to learn to use the power of social media and how it will be to their advantage. Guiding them to post engaging pictures would increase the number of likes on their site and hopefully lead to a closed sale. They have to learn how to trust the use of e-wallet as a form of payment transaction without using actual cash. We are working with our communities on this. Coffee for Peace wants to bring the produce of our farmers in the hands of the local consumers so that we can stimulate economic activities in our country. We employ some tribal people, out of school youth, and mothers who are unemployable because of lack of education, and train them on the coffee business. I would like to challenge you to become part of the solution. Let us support our local farmers and coffee producers. Let us practice zero exclusion by loving our marginalized people in our society. Zero carbon by being mindful on how we manage our waste. And zero poverty by increasing the move toward economic situation that creates job and wealth. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Georgie, for that very inspiring presentation as well. We learned that there's an extinction of the coffee species due to the global warming that could lead to poorer quality and higher prices. So there is now a need to protect the coffee habitat. The Coffee for Peace philosophy of harmony with the creator, with creation, with others, and with self. She also talked about the Coffee for Peace value chain from farm to shelf, resulting in improvement in the farming community across many levels, and also some of the problems such as infrastructure and discrimination that need to be addressed. And of course, the effect of COVID in slowing down business, but also causing them to pivot by using social media and e-wallets to adapt to the new normal. And finally, practicing inclusivity by encouraging women to be involved in your projects. Thank you so much, Ms. Georgie. Later, we will be asking you some questions. But for now, we'll go on with our third speaker. It's an honor to introduce our third speaker, Mr. Arnold Balais. He's a Philippine Paralympic athlete and a right above knee amputee. He won gold medals for bench press powerlifting in Malaysia in 2002 and held silver and bronze medals for 100 meter butterfly and freestyle relay swimming events at the fourth ASEAN Paralympic Games in Thailand. He's the first amputee to reach the peak of Mount Apo. The team captain of the first ever differently abled and highly successful Dragon Boat team, the Philippine Accessible Disability Services Incorporated, or PADS. He was the athlete that lit the urn during the opening ceremonies of the 2005 ASEAN Games and was a torchbearer in one international event. He was also chosen by Alaksan to be the face of its TV commercial, Power Over Pain, in the hope of inspiring others to share his story with the rest of the world. So now let's welcome Arnold. All right. Hi, Arnold.
Hello, everyone. Good afternoon. Thank you, Ms. Nina, for that introduction. Thank you also to the organizer for giving me a golden opportunity to share my resilience story. My name is Arnold Balais. I'm 46 years old. I'm married. I have 3 children. I'm right above the knee amputee. Presently, I'm working as a laboratory instructor, a prosthetic and orthotic technician, and patient advocate at Cebu Doctors University, Cebu. I am also a motivational and inspirational speaker. Before I move on with my talk, I'd like to invite everyone to a virtual exercise. No? Please imagine yourself standing with one leg for 10 seconds. All right, thanks a lot. Now, the reason why I asked you to do that is for you to understand and experience how to be an amputee, even for just 10 seconds. Captain A here is a amputee for 30 years now, and I managed to navigate the in and outs of being an amputee. It's all about balance. No, if my patient can stand, can hop, and can jump with one leg, most of the time, they can walk with the artificial leg. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. I was born and raised in Roosevelt, Dilalupihan, Bataan. I was the youngest in the family. I have one older sister and one older brother. My father is a plumber and alcoholic. My mother is a do-it-all mother and a religious one. We grew up in a simple setup. We don't have the access to electricity and water. Next slide, please. And we use firewood in cooking. Me and my older brother is tasked to fetch water every day and collect firewood on the firewoods on weekends. The mountains and river of Roosevelt, Dilalupihan, Bataan became our playground, and it helped me to become an athletic kid. At a very young age also, we were already taught the basic household chores like dishwashing, which is my favorite, washing our own clothes, and cleaning our home, and of course, cooking also. Next slide, please. Growing up, I wanted to be an architect and a professional basketball player. I was very athletic. I was a member of track and field. I'm a sprinter during my elementary days, and I graduated salutatorian. I was 14 years old when my ambition was put on hold because of a freak accident while playing basketball, while contesting for a rebound. I had a bad fall, and it was badly injured and got infected, and resulted to amputation. Next slide, please. I consider that as my lowest point. It was very painful and physically and also emotionally. It was hard for my family, financially very in debt. And two things might happen if you're in lowest point of your life. It's either you stay on the bottom or you crawl your way up. And Captain A here chose to crawl his way up, literally. Next slide. If you have your lowest point, of course, you should have also your turning point. No, 3 things again. You have to recognize your problem. You have to accept your problem. And of course, you have to face the reality. When my leg was amputated, I had to face the reality that for the rest of my life, I'll be an amputee. Next slide. Rehabilitation is very important in my recovery. The UST Hospital Rehab Department under Dr. Reyes gave a program for me, a physical therapy program, and she gave me artificial leg and also a job as a vocational coordinator. And she granted me a training in America for plastic fabrication for 2 months. Next slide. They have a vocational training that offer vocational courses for persons with disability. Next slide. I decided to improve my body by enrolling in a local gym in Sampaloc. And fortunately, the instructor was really impressed with my strength, and he encouraged me to join a bench press powerlifting. Coach Monty Mendigoria designed a program that will suit my disability. And the rest is history. I became a champion local and national bench press competition. And in 1995, I represent our country in bench press qualifier in Atlanta, Georgia. Next slide. 2001, when I shifted to swimming. Swimming. Maybe you will wonder, how can I swim? I only have one leg. But again, remember, I still have two hands, the left and the right. And I still have left leg. It's only a matter of how do you badly want it. With determination and dedication, I was able to finally get my first gold medal in 50-meter freestyle in the first ASEAN Para Games in Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. And I also won silver in bench press powerlifting. Next slide. Captain A also is into Ironman. We have a relay team in Cebu. Our member is below elbow. Our biker is below elbow. And our runner is a shoulder disarticulation. And of course, Captain A right above the knee. And we name our team as Team Incomplete. Pero malupit. And of course, one of my bucket list is to climb Mount Apo. And in 2013, I successfully reached the peak of Mount Apo and recognized as the first amputee to reach the peak of Mount Apo. Next slide. Presently, Captain A is into Dragon Boat. I'm the team captain of PADS. PADS is a very unique team in the country. Majority of our members are persons with disability. And last year, we won in the 14th IDBF World Championship. We won 4 golds in para dragon category. And because of that, we were given a chance to visit Malacanang and have a courtesy call to our president. He was so happy with our gold medal, and he gave us a incentives. And 8 of us who are amputee in the team, he gave us a artificial leg. Next slide. I consider my family as my pillars of strength, not only pillars of strength, but also my inspiration. My father and mother in Iloilo, my sister and brother, they're always there to support me. And of course, my own family right now, my 3 daughters and my ever supportive and loving wife, Donna. Next slide. So what is behind the success of Captain A? Captain A, next slide. Captain A went through countless times of mistakes, losses, rejection, frustration, disappointments, failures, and insults. But all of this made Captain A stronger and better athlete and a person. No matter how difficult your challenges, just keep moving forward. Don't ever give up. This photo is very important for me. It's a constant reminder for me to stay grounded and always value the sacrifices of my mother. And also to be grateful to all the people who helped me along the way. And I'm always grateful for the following people who practiced zero exclusion, especially Dr. Opelia Reyes of UST Hospital Rehab Department. Coach Monte Mendigoria, who trained me for powerlifting, and of course, UniLab for giving me opportunity to where I am right now. Who would have thought that the boy who lost his right leg, hopeless, helpless, would become this man today? The journey is really amazing. Even now, hindi pa rin ako makapaniwala na eto na si Arnold. Thankful for the opportunity. 2017, I was given a chance to replace Senator Manny Pacquiao as the new face of Alaksan. Next slide. So my challenge to you this afternoon, if Captain A did it with one leg, there is no reason for you not to achieve or to reach your goals, your dreams, with two legs. Again, I am Arnold, Captain A Balais. Thank you very much and maayong hapon sa iyong tanan.
Daghang salamat, Captain A.
Thank you
for sharing your awe-inspiring story and that laban lang attitude, no? Perfect, especially for these trying times. Let me just recap a bit of what you said. Arnold talked about his humble beginnings, an experience similar to many of our kababayans. He suffered an accident at 14 years old, resulting in his amputation, the lowest point of his life, which led to his turning point as well, where he recognized the problem, accepted it, and faced his reality. He engaged in multiple sports, weightlifting, swimming, triathlon, mountaineering, dragon boat, with multiple events and awards. And finally, he draws strength from family, accepting failure, but continuing to move forward. And very thankful for those who champion inclusivity. So maraming salamat, Arnold. We can't wait to hear more from you later.
Thank you.
And now let's move on to our last speaker, our fourth and last but not the least, no? We have Mr. Jeffrey Tarayao. He's the president of One Meralco Foundation, served as chairman of the League of Corporate Foundations and president of the Coalition for Better Education. He's the first Filipino to be elected as trustee of the Humanitarian Leadership Academy based in London. As president of One Meralco Foundation, he has expanded its community electrification program, which benefited more than 50,000 low-income households and energized 250 remote off-grid public schools using solar power in the past 9 years. Jeff was chosen as one of Manila's 40 under 40 international development leaders given by the Washington, D.C.-based Development Exchange. The Asian New Zealand Foundation recognized him as one of Asia's young business leaders in 2014. He was also conferred by the University of Santo Tomas, Manila, as the Outstanding Tomasian Alumni Young Achiever in 2008 and completed his Master's of Sustainable Development degree in Macquarie University in 2018 as an Australia Award Scholar. We are pleased to introduce Mr. Jeffrey Tarayao of One Meralco Foundation.
Good afternoon. Magandang hapon po sa inyong lahat. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Oh, good. Thank you for inviting me in this idea exchange, no, about very critical issues that we must face together. Well, for about 20 years now, I have been involved in corporate social responsibility, community relations, and sustainability work. Sorry, I'm trying to control my presentation. There. 9 years ago, when I led the reorganization of the One Meralco Foundation, which is the corporate foundation of Meralco, we thought that the most important area where we could be of strategic and meaningful impact is through electrification, particularly those who are deprived of access to reliable and safe electricity. Over time, we also discovered that many of our children in remote communities around the country do not really enjoy the same level of learning opportunities as those who go to schools with electricity. So we've also put up a program for that. Further, as energy issues become more challenging, we thought that through energy education, we may be able to develop more responsible energy consumers, especially among our youth. Within the Meralco franchise area, our priority is to make access to electricity within the reach of every family, whether they're rich or poor, to increase their productivity and quality of life. Through our household electrification program, at least 50,000 low-income households have electricity flowing in their homes now. Many are unable to pay for their own power connection due to financial and documentary hurdles. And residents and communities often fall prey to opportunists who offer unauthorized service access for a monthly fee that is way higher than what Meralco usually charges, no? Baka yung naririnig niyong submetering, maraming entrepreneurial Pinoy na gumagawa niyan. However, this has dire consequences. Let's say, for example, substandard copper wires and faulty wiring often lead to electrocution and large-scale fires, leaving families homeless and even resulting in deaths. And this is the reason why we have been helping low-income families realize their electric dreams. The program brings together the foundation, of course, Meralco, the local government units, and community homeowners associations to work out solutions to problems barring electrification. This includes providing assistance for service wires, metering centers, or electrical facilities extensions. And, you know, working with the local government to expedite the government permits because those are needs for electricity subscription. And then we learned that through this program, families are able to save from about 100 pesos to 800 pesos a month from the bills they used to pay via submetering. Because now, they have their own electric meters. They only pay for the amount of electricity that they actually consume. And in communities that are far away from the power grid, Meralco has already inaugurated or put up solar microgrids. For example, in Cagbalete Island in Quezon, which provides round-the-clock electricity to 129 households there. We also installed the same in Verde Island, Batangas. The residents are now able to use electricity 24 hours a day and are able to use other appliances. In contrast, when they were dependent on generators, they could only connect a few light bulbs and they had to pay a premium if they insisted on using other devices such as television or an electric fan. But something very important to me personally is education, no? Maybe if we can go back to the earlier slide. There. You know, thousands of schools are literally groping in the dark. The reason energizing these far-flung schools is close to impossible. But we at the foundation look at challenges with a positive perspective. While we are aware of the bounds of our resources, we strive to innovate and look for solutions to this problem. And sometimes it is not inside our head, but thousands of miles above it. In this case, the sun. Ang araw pala yung solution, no? Just like our vision, the sun shines for all of us, not distinguishing between the rich and the poor. It is energy for everyone. So why not use to benefit, you know, why not use it to benefit everyone? And this is the idea behind the foundation school electrification program. It spreads the light to off-grid mountain and island schools by harnessing solar power to electrify the schools. Through the program, some 89,000 students in 252 remote public schools get to experience technology-aided learning, something that has been the norm in more progressive communities, but almost unheard of in these far-flung villages. Each school also received a multimedia package consisting of laptop computers, a printer, and an LED TV donated by Meralco employees. But more than just providing electricity, the program levels off the playing field for students in these schools, giving them a head start in their quest for a better life. Moreover, during the pandemic, this solution provided to be a pillar of resilience for these remote communities. Let me show you why.
Hindi biro ang online at modular learning. Paano pa kaya ang mga walang kuryente at nasa malayo? Ganito ang buhay ng mga public school teachers ng Santo Niño Island, Samar.
Dati po, 4 to 10 p.m. lang may kuryente sa buong genset lang kasi ang gumagana dito. Normal na sa amin ang walang kuryente pagpasukan. Magbabangka pa kami sa mainland para gumamit ng computer at mag-print ng modules o test papers. Madalas, sariling gastos pa namin yon, lalong humirap nang nagka-pandemya dahil online o modular na ang pagtuturo. Delikado pang bumalik-balik sa mainland dahil sa pandemic.
Kaya nakipagtulungan ang Juan Meralco Foundation sa DepEd para maghatid sa kanila ng solar energy.
Salamat sa Meralco at sa pag-install nila ng solar power sa amin. May kuryente na kami buong araw. At dahil nabigyan pa kami ng laptops at printers, di na namin kailangang lumayo. Life-changing po ito para sa mga teachers at students namin.
Higit na kailangan ngayon ng mga guro at mag-aaral ang kuryente upang maipagpatuloy ang kanilang edukasyon. Sa tulong ng solar energy, makakaasa kayong patuloy na maghahatid ng liwanag ang Juan Meralco Foundation, lalong-lalo na sa pinakamalalayong paaralan sa ating bansa.
Katulad nito at ng solar electrification programs noong 2019 sa Isla Verde at Cagbalete Island, tuloy-tuloy po ang Meralco sa pagbibigay liwanag. Ngayong panahon ng pandemya, kung magtutulungan tayo, may liwanag ang bagong bukas.
I think this is one clear example where if you're able to invest in the poor, no, especially sometimes the neglected communities are in our country, they are able to really empower themselves, no, by providing them the right tools, the right capabilities, and they will rise above issues like a pandemic. For me, the school electrification program proved that when we invest in the most marginalized communities, build their capabilities, and create a system of support, of community support, they become resilient amidst challenges, including in a health or economic pandemic, or sometimes probably in leadership problems. If I am to apply the 3-0 principles in this program, we have built an ecosystem of inclusion, of opportunity growth, with the lowest carbon footprint possible. I think providing access to electricity in various forms is what makes the future generation stand, and helping them appreciate its limitless benefits and unleash its full potential. It's what drives them forward. In summary, I think there are many 3-0 models available to us. And particularly if we invest in these models in our struggling communities, a meaningful, shared, and inclusive growth can be possible. By instituting systems change, strengthening a network of support, building local capabilities, and investing on technologies that promote a carbon-free lifestyle, we may be able to experience in our lifetime what it is to live and grow meaningfully together. When there is an inclusive approach to action, we recognize the need for all people to be involved in the decisions that affect their lives. In closing, let me share with you the story of how we invested in the community of a young leader from an indigenous community in South Cotabato. Probably, this 3-0 concept can lead into a vicious circular system of generosity and greatness of spirit, like how Alex Labi did it by going back to his community to lead development there.
Actually, yung mga katutubo, kahit maliit pa yun, so yung edukasyon na tinatawag, wala yun sa vocabulary nila. Bata pa lang ako, may teacher na ako, so nasubaybayan ko mismo yung kahirapan. Sabi ko, darating ang panahon na matutulungan ko sila.
Ang School Electrification Program ng One Meralco Foundation ay sinimula natin noong 2012. We realized that many of our schools, especially those located in remote islands and communities, really need basic electricity. When we first met Alex 5 years ago, he's a very good student leader. At nung nakausap ko sa noon, sinasabi niyang, pag nakagraduate siya sa Kibang at pag-aaral siya ng education, babalik ako para makapagturo ako sa aming pamayanan. If you are able to empower students like Alex, and the teachers and the other students see that as an inspiration, and then they receive a solar power equipment like this, it's a perfect combination of how you actually help fulfill dreams.
Just a parting word, I think all of us, if not many of us here, are converted already. And we might get upset that in many occasions, our children do not listen to us. But the fact is, they are always watching us. So it is our responsibility to model the way. Maraming salamat po at magandang maliwanag na hapon sa inyong lahat.
Maraming salamat, Mr. Jeffrey Tarayao, for that wonderful presentation and those powerful videos that you showed us this afternoon. Let me just recap your presentation. You said that the lack of electricity resulted in inequality in education among the youth, and the realization that electricity makes communities more productive, and providing real solutions and working with stakeholders such as the community and LGUs to eliminate barriers for communities to get electricity. The importance of using innovative solution or innovative solutions and natural resources such as solar power for off-the-grid areas. But more than electricity, it was so important to also provide tools such as computers, laptops, and printers for educational needs. Investing in people builds their capability to be resilient and to help themselves. Thank you so much, Jeff, for inspiring us. Okay, now let's move on to the Q&A portion of our plenary. Let's see, sinong nagpadala ng mga questions? Maybe I should start, I guess, with my own question while waiting for the questions to come in. Let me start with our first speaker, Ms. Mikey. Mikey, you're a personality and people look up to you, especially in this age of social media, and it's now so much easier to get the word out. People are now more aware of what's going on. And I don't know if, I'm sure some of you have already seen the Netflix documentary, the David Attenborough documentary. He was saying that when people do not see, they do not care. So Ms. Mikey, you're an influencer, you have a voice. How now can we convert this unprecedented awareness, into action?
Well, to be honest, I'm not very good at social media. And I should actually take more advantage of it and try to really get the message out there. It's a challenge, really, because even when I try to analyze my own accounts and see what kind of posts are given attention, what are given likes or not, it can be frustrating because normally I get more reactions for the more showbiz things. yes. But I think we just have to persist. I think when we have something important that we want to share, something significant that we really believe should be out there, I think we just have to persist. We just have to keep trying to get everyone to understand. And you know, we never know. Maybe someone will read the same message at a time when it could hit them more, when it would have more significance in their life. So I think we just have to do that. And personally, it doesn't really feel like a lot of people are watching me. I just kind of put my head down and, you know, keep going. So that's what I try to do. And really, ultimately, I work for the audience of one. So that's really just how I go by the things that I do, and I try to lend support to organizations and causes that I know and trust.
Yes, Ms. Mikey, you're right, because kanina si Jeff was talking about we are watching you. So even if you say you think we're not watching you, you have almost 100,000 followers on Instagram, and people are watching and listening. And we hope you don't get tired of posting pa rin, along with the showbiz. That's how it is, I guess, these days, no? It's just hard to translate that awareness into action, which is, I guess, do you think that's the most challenging part of what we're doing today?
Always, always. And I think even with ourselves, you know, as much as we understand, as much as we want to do things, we still get encouraged by each other. We still need to get pushed by each other. So, you know, I think it's in that sense that we actually are more open to learning from each other. So we have to also be there for each other, because the work that we do is not really easy, but we know how important it is. So, you know, I am very blessed to have people who guide me, who give me constructive criticism when it's necessary. So, yes, we just have to keep going. It's our responsibility.
Thank you, Mikey. Now, we move on to Miss Georgie, the recent winner, you know, of this Mala Nobel Peace Prize of Business from Oslo. Ms. Georgie, alam mo, I can really relate to your presentation, because I'm a coffee addict. And I think everyone is now into coffee. When I see my IG feed, everyone is buying beans and gadgets, no, pour over, ganyan. So now people want to buy local to help the communities, as with clothes, like, you know, the slow fashion movement that I'm also part with, even food and music, no? Love local is now the in thing. Unfortunately, we've heard of instances where coffee is being imported from our Asian neighbors like Vietnam and Thailand and being sold as local. When I found out about this, I was really heartbroken. I could not believe it na yung binil ko from, let's say, kunyari raw, Sagada, hindi pala galing sa Sagada. So this is to the detriment of our local farmers. Ms. Georgie, what do you think, what are the initiatives that are being done about this this problem?
Right now, as part of the Region 11 Coffee Council, we are talking about GIS, geographical identification for the origin of coffee, so that we could prevent those people who are claiming that their coffee is from this place, tapos hindi pala, galing pala sa ibang lugar. So we wanted to protect kasi the farmers, because they work hard for their coffee and then they lose their identity as their coffee, because it's being sold as another brand or as another origin. So as part of the Coffee Council, we are lobbying for that to our Department of Agriculture and Department of Trade and Industry. And that's how we could help them.
Kailangan talaga, no, mabantayan to, Ms. Georgie, kasi maraming naloloko ngayon. And people really have that, you know, good intentions. We really want to buy local now. So, nagkaroon ng parang renewed sense of nationalism, especially during this pandemic. In fact, ako, I really buy from the farmer themselves. So, I know the name of the farmer. We have it shipped from Mindanao to Manila. I guess that's how I'm trying to, my family is trying to help in this kind of situation, no, to really get it straight from the farmers themselves. So we hope good luck, ha, sana, and that people are more aware now that some of the coffee are not really from where it says they are.
Yeah, yeah. Like, yeah, you can see 75% of the coffee that we drink as Filipinos, with 110 million Filipinos, comes from different country, from other country. Mm-hmm. And that's why we are really strengthening our coffee farmers, Robusta coffee farmers and Arabica coffee farmers, to really love what they do, because there's a great potential within our own country itself. Therefore, we could boost our economy if we buy our local coffee.
Mm-hmm. So you, and nakita na namin your award-winning coffee. From Oslo, no, that the very prestigious award that is now in the news headlines. Okay, thank you so much, Miss Georgie. Now we move on to Mr. Arnold, Captain A, Super A, the real life superhero. Alam mo, Arnold, tagus puso yung presentation mo. I want to know, I know that it's your family that really gave you so much support, but you're such a great athlete. Did you have any idol athletes or people you looked up to in sports while you were growing up that influenced you?
Yes, favorite player ko si Samboy Lim, the Skywalker.
Yes.
Pinapattern ko yung game ko sa kanya. Not only that magaling siya mag-basketball, but ano siya, well-loved siya ng mga fans talaga. Napaka-down-to-earth na player. At saka mabait. Even sa practice nila talaga nanonood ako just to makita ko lang siya. Kasi sa PBA talagang sikat na sikat si Samboy Lim.
Yes. Oo nga, totoo yan, ano, Arnold. And ang tanong ko eh, bakit gano'ng ka-importante yung ganyan, meron kang inspirasyon. But hindi lang inspirasyon, but also great parang community that supported you, no? And rallied behind you in your quest for greatness.
Importante talaga yung, ano eh, yung may inspirasyon ka. Kasi, alam mo, pag atleta, katulad ni Ma'am Mikey, atleta rin yan siya. May dumarating na point na nabe-burn out din kami. Itasawa na kami sa ginagawa namin, parang routine na lang eh. Like sa training namin, we woke up 5 a.m. para mag-swimming na, tapos matatapos, ulitin mo na naman sa hapon. Pero kailangan may inspiration ka talaga para to keep you, ano eh, to keep you motivated. Ngayon, napa-end na yung career. So ngayon, ginagawa ko naman is helping other kids na may mga disability. Sa kanila namin pinapasa eh, what we learned during our time ng mga athlete pa kami, malaking tulong ngayon eh, kasi nakikita nila, may prepa naman, they saw how we perform. So, mas naniniwala sila, credible na, oh, si Captain A yan, parang ganun eh. So, I have to protect my name also, but I really love to ipasa, no, pass it forward yung mga nangyari sa akin. Especially sa mga bata na less fortunate na mga disabled. Kulang eh. I believe sa sports talaga malaking matutulong para ma-uplift sila, makalimutan nila yung disability nila pag na-engage sila sa sports, ma-develop lahat sa kanila. And I can attest to that.
Oo. Maganda. Iba talaga, no? Pag meron kang sports, iba yung disiplina at di ba, yung ambisyon na meron ka as an athlete, no? Anong mensahe mo siguro sa mga magulang, Arnold, who may tend to be overprotective sa kanilang mga anak who are differently abled?
Opo, totoo yan, no? Even yung nanay ko, dumaan din kami sa ganyang sitwasyon, no? Kasi sa culture natin, hindi pa tanggap na may kapansanan yung mga tao, eh, no? Actually, ano lang eh, sanayan lang yan eh. Huwag na silang mahiya, expose nila yung mga anak nila na may kapansanan. Kasi the more na itago, lalo hindi matutulungan. Pero pag in-expose mo yan, mas madaming tutulong. Madami tayong organization na iba't ibang different organization na tumutulong sa mga persons with disability. Na mas active na ngayon, no, yung Philippine Sports Commission. We now have the PhilSpada, which is the National Sports Association for Differently Abled. So wala nang problema, no, ngayon recognized na tayo ng PSC, ng IOC, at okay na lahat, planchado na lahat. And again, ulit ko sa mga parents, expose niyo po yung anak niyo. Lahat po yan, may mga talent. Si Captain A, maybe sa sports ako nag-excel. I don't know, sa ibang bata. Maybe sa music, sa arts, sa acting. Meron po yan. Kailangan natin expose sila.
Kailangan so, lang i-tap, no? Opo. And support and really encourage. Hindi itago just because may disability. Maraming salamat, Arnold. Mapunta naman tayo kay Sir Jeffrey. Nakita namin how special your relationship is with the communities that you have helped. But let me ask you personally, what are your most memorable life experiences that made you relate to these people more?
Oh, well, you know, every visit to a community is a memorable one. In fact, let's say, for example, those are 245 schools that we've energized. I would have probably gone to more than half of it, no? And each one has a very different experience. But whenever I go to these communities and see the kind of change that we're able to bring, no? Or to facilitate, not really bring, but to facilitate, I always remember my parents, no? Because my parents, lumaki silang mahirap, eh. We grew up in a very poor family. And their only contribution to us was education, no? And that is the reason why I think whether we're young or old, education is a very important factor to navigate a very difficult life. Diba? If you have a difficult life in terms of material possession or material resources, it's even harder if you lack the knowledge that you are able to do something, di ba? Mas mahirap yun, di ba? Parang yung sineshare ni Arnold na may kapansanan ka na, pagkatapos kulang ka pa sa pagkalinga sa sarili mo. Mas mahirap yun. And for me, those are the things that I learn from the communities every time I visit the communities. That's why for me, hindi ako pumupunta kapag turnover lang ng school electrification. It's more important for me to go when we're deciding if we're going to give a solution to the community or not. Because that's part of journeying with the community and letting them understand that this goes beyond the equipment that's being donated to them.
Right.
It's helping them grow on their own. Means lang itong electrification para mas lumaki ka pa, mas maging ganap ka pa. So okay. I think those are really memorable situations or memorable occasions for me.
Thank you for sharing that. Sir Jeffrey, meron pang tanong dito no, from Erica Nang Wong. Are you looking into the possibility of turning waste into energy, just like how Singapore is doing aside from solar energy? Since waste is one of our major concerns in the Philippines, would be great to hit two birds with one stone on this. What are your thoughts?
Actually, that is an existing solution already. The challenge is scaling it up. And in scaling it up, we need very important actors like government and investors. So I guess we need to prod them more. Ano? Itong mga solutions na to require a big ecosystem of support and contribution. But there are solutions already. It's a matter of scaling it up and engaging our government leaders and the business sector to invest more on this.
Sana nga, no? Parang Juan Meralco Foundation. Si Carlos Capuchon, may question siya for Mikey and Captain A. His question is, how can private companies help support the Olympic movement in the Philippines, most especially for the Paralympics? Let's start with Mikey.
Okay, well, you know, for one thing, sport internationally has become very scientific, and there's a lot of focus on really studying the different elements of a human body and what makes us perform better. When you say that you want to support the Olympic movement, it presupposes an intention to participate internationally and to represent your country. So at this stage, if we're going to talk about athletes, one of the areas that we need to focus more on as Filipino athletes is nutrition and conditioning. It improves stamina, it improves, you know, it's sport specific. So it doesn't just mean na kahit anong sport mo, papasok ka sa gym, isa lang yung workout mo. You really have to study what you need to develop and what you need to improve. Also, because I mentioned earlier, it's not always about money. And in sport, it's also not really about money. So even the IOC receives a lot of contributions in kind. So it depends on the nature of the company. What do you produce? What do you manufacture? Or even what assets do you have that you can lend? Maybe it's space. Maybe it's a sports psychologist. Maybe it's someone who is very good with making a website or technical matters or, you know, or an accountant maybe, because remember that behind sports is not just the athletes, but also the administrators, the organizers, the officials who referee the game. So there's a lot of elements to developing athletes and to developing sports in the country. So it all has to come together. And while a monetary donation would give organizers and administrators the flexibility, you know, we'll take what we can get, even just to show support by watching our amateur athletes compete, being spectators, because even that attracts sponsors to come and to contribute, you know. So even just showing interest is an inspiration already to us athletes. Diba, Arnold? Diba, Captain A?
Arnold?
Yung panood ka lang, palakpakan ka lang ng mga nanonood. It's actually very encouraging. Di ba, Arnold?
Opo, totoo po yan, Ma'am Mikey. Napaka-importante para sa amin yung support ng mga kababayan natin. No? When we know that they are behind us while lumalangoy kami or whatever sports na ginagawa namin, nakaka-boost yan ng moral mo eh. Na alam mo na pinagdadasal ka nila, they're cheering for you kahit nasa malayong competition. I learned no, na importante talaga yung character ng isang athlete. I think dapat ma-address yun na beside the sport, kailangan din i-build yung character eh. Yung saan tayo no, bilang atleta, hindi lang puro galing, hindi lang puro ano. Ano yung pagkatapos nun, di ba? Kailangan maging mabuting tao tayo. No? Kasi yung sport, binigay sa atin yan, it's a gift from sa, ng Panginoon. Gamitin natin na mabuti. No? Natutunan ka na magaling ka nga, bastos ka naman, hindi mo alam galing eh. No? Kasi nung bata pa tayo, parang kaya natin lahat gawin, kala mo hindi ka matatalo. Pero pag natalo ka, you learn a lesson na ay, I have to go back from zero. Masyadong lumaki yung ulo ko. No? So I think importante na character building for our athletes. Importante yung spiritual din. Nakakalimutan na minsan eh. No? Parang, no, magaling na ako, hindi ko na kailangan itong mga to. But at the end of the day, importante siya. Kasi pag nag-retire ka, when you have your own family, yung mga anak mo, paano mo sila palalakihin? No? Kailangan magamit mo yung natutunan mo bilang isang athlete.
Yan, maraming salamat. Arnold, Mikey, both of you are such inspirations in your fields. No? Sabi nga ni Nelson Mandela, sports has the power to change the world. And right. Just by sharing your stories and encouraging others to be interested in sports watching, tama yun, no? Manood lang, just to show up or mag-log on, di ba? Mag-like, gives a big boost to our Filipino athletes. So thank you so much for that. Sir Jeff, here's another question for you from Anton Mary Lim. The Yellow Boat of Hope is helping last mile coastal schools. A lot of them are off-grid. How can we work together po, especially at this time when we need printers and computers to work?
I think there are opportunities for us to work with the very successful Yellow Boat of Hope. We just have to connect with each other. You can check us out on our Facebook page. And you can connect us there.
Okay. Now we have another question for Ms. Pantoja. Ms. Georgie, no? Philippine Coffee has won a number of awards in tasting competitions overseas. Should the priority be in pushing recognition of our beans worldwide or the domestic market first?
I think domestic market first. Mm. We have to conquer our own people to love our own coffee because we have good coffee here in our country. We are blessed because we have the four varieties of coffee here. We have the Robusta, the Excelsa, Liberica, and the Arabica. And when I started in the coffee industry in 2006, 2008 and 2011, we have exported coffee already in Canada and in the USA. But what we are lacking is promoting it to our own people. And this is our lobby for our own people. At least let's apply the rule or the policy that at least 15% of the required goods of the government offices be bought from local producers. Mm-mm. So if we can have those, then we help more of our farmers. If we are getting our coffee from other ASEAN countries like Indonesia or Malaysia, 75% of those are from there, and only 25% supports our own farmers. Can we not increase our buying of our local coffee because it would help more our farmers? We have so many farmers that we have witnessed, and they would always complain, we have no buyers because it's not reaching the market. Why? it's controlled by whoever can advertise more, and the local producers remain poor. And how many farmers do we have? So many. So sana all of us would really love our own product and would really buy our own product so that we can stimulate our local economy and help our own people rather than always buying imported goods. We have so many good products here. Not just coffee.
Yes.
Cacao, we have, you know, the Inabel.
Yes, I'm wearing one right now, Inabel, from my province of Ilocos Norte.
Yeah, so I'm wearing a product of the Blaan tribe and the Kalinga people. So let's try to promote and sponsor our own local producers. Then it would help all of us. Then talagang walang iwanan.
Thank you so much. Talagang, alam mo, uso ngayon ng Filipino, kaya lalo na today is Friday, may nagpauso ng Filipino Fashion Friday. So everyone's posting on social media any product, no, that's made in the Philippines. The Love Local movement is really on the rise, and we can see that social media is helping. So thank you so much. Now we go back to Mr. Jeff Tarayao. In the world market, the price of renewables like wind and solar are dropping and becoming more affordable over the years. How's the renewable market doing in the Philippines?
Oh, well, it's growing, but we need to grow faster. Again, it's a question of two things. First, the appetite of our government to invest more on renewable. And second, the appetite of investors, no, to invest on renewable. But, you know, there's also hope for other types of investors. I think last week I had a discussion with Luis on this. We were thinking on how our poor can participate in the growth of renewable. And there are many technologies available already. You see, when it comes to energy investments, parang laging nako-corner yan ang big players lang. Our challenge now is maybe the academe, the private sector, the non-profit sector should all come together and think of new ways, you know, to involve our marginalized communities to be involved in developing solutions for renewable na maaari nang gamitin ng ating mga kababayan. You know, for example, you know, there are many solar roofs available already. How if one entire community, Agawad Kalinga community, would have solar roofs on their in their community and generate power on their own for their own consumption, at yung sobra ay ibebenta natin sa grid, and that becomes a social enterprise for them. I think that is the reason why a 3-0 solution or a 3-0 framework should be made available for everyone, so that we can all come together and check ano ba yung mga ganitong capabilities na meron tayo para maging puhunan ng ating mga naghihirap na kababayan. No? So there are already technologies available for that. It's now the appetite for us to implement it on our own.
Okay. Thank you for that, Jeffrey. And now our last question for all of you to answer. How do we get everyone to do what you're doing to challenge the status quo, such as the exception becomes the norm? Okay, let's start with Mikey.
I was afraid you'd say that.
From the first speaker, second, and the last speaker, see Jeffrey. Okay.
Well, I'm not so sure how to answer that. I think it takes a team. You know what? Very young when my parents started reminding me how blessed I am. And the fact that, and this was always an example that they used, the fact that you will probably never go hungry in your life, that you would never have to struggle to find your next meal, is already a blessing in itself. And that reason alone should compel you to be a blessing to others. And I don't know what the answer to that is, and maybe that's why we're here. That's why we've been brought together to share our stories, because I don't think there's one story that's more important than the other. You know, I think everything that we each are doing is just in our hopes to be good Christians, to bring praise and glory to God by serving each other. There was a very wise professor that one day asked me, put in order of importance to you these three things, country, family, and God. And I said, well, you know what, this is really a trick question, and I don't know the answer to this. And he said, well, number one should be God. And I said, oh, really? Okay. I understand, but why? And he said, because God loves us all equally. So, you know, he only wants the best for everyone. So whatever he puts before you is for the good of all. Okay. And I said, so what's next? And he said, country. And I said, huh? Really? Country? And at that time, my kids were very young. So I was like, oh, they're my sun, moon, and stars. And he said, yes, country, because you love your children, right? Yeah, of course, I love my children. I love my whole family. And he said, exactly. It's exactly that love that might be blinding you from realizing that what you're taking, what you're working for, is actually going to you, and you're taking something away from someone else who needs it more. So if you love your country more than you love your family, and you make your decisions based on what would be better for the greater number of people, you and your family will also benefit from that.
Very well said.
I never forgot that, yeah.
That's very wise words. Thank you so much, Mikey Kawanko Jaworski. We move on to Miss Georgie.
I think I will go back to the values that we have as Coffee for Peace. And this is relational harmony. It's the four harmony that I talked about on my slide presentation. Number one is harmony with your creator. If you respect that somebody higher than you created this earth, then you know that you have to submit to that creator. Second would be relational harmony with yourself. When you have that relation with your creator, when you question yourself, why am I here for? What's my purpose in life? And it's only you and your creator can answer that. Therefore, you will not poison yourself. You will not put any drugs or over drink or, you know, over smoke because you wanted to protect yourself that was created by your creator. Next would be relational harmony with others. If you had a hard time finding yourself and finding the meaning of your life, then you will be patient with others who are still journeying. And this is always our message to different religious groups, because we here in Mindanao, we are dealing with Muslim, the Christians, and the indigenous faith. And we don't want to convert people, but rather let them see how we live our lives. So if you have that relational harmony with your creator, relational harmony with yourself, you will have the love and compassion and patience for the others. Therefore, you will treat them justly and fairly and peacefully. Mm. The last harmony is relational harmony with the creation. I will not poison the earth that we live in because you and I will suffer. Therefore, being mindful of what we do. So it starts with yourself, how you live your life. So are you throwing waste and polluting the earth? Or are you being mindful and recycling your waste and being conscious? How do I behave? And that's how I would answer and encourage other people. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ms. Georgie Pantoja of Coffee for Peace. Ngayon, puntahan naman natin si Arnold. The question, I guess, in simpler words, is how do we inspire others to act right now?
Yes, ma'am. I always believe na things happen for a reason. Bakit kami lahat nandito? I think may iba-iba kami ina-address, no, para sa mga kababayan natin na nangangailangan ng inspirasyon, especially ngayon na nasa gitna tayo ng pandemic. Ihiramin ko yung sinabi ni Mrs. Gump, kay Forrest Gump. Sabi niya, be the best of what God did. Alam mo, tumatak sa utak ko talaga yun eh. Nung naputulan ako ng paa, naging mentality ko na na I'll be the best amputee in the Philippines, no? Parang ganun, no? I want to inspire yung mga kababayan natin na kung ano man yung meron kayo, palaging best yung isipin niya, no? Maging best ako na ganito. So, unti-unti, naging natutupad yung mga pinapangarap ko, no? Dati, hindi ko yan lubos maisip na kahit pala putol yung paa ko, marami pa pala akong magagawa, magkakaasawa ko pala ako, magkakaanak pa ako. Very thankful talaga sa lahat ng mga taong ginamit ng Panginoon na instrumento. Naniniwala ko na hindi mo kaya mag-isa. No, kailangan, tama yung sinabi ni Ma'am Mikey, teamwork talaga ang kailangan para ma-inspire natin yung buong bansa at malagpasan natin, no, ano man itong pinagdadaan natin ngayon. At palagi tayong maniwala na merong light at the end of the tunnel.
Thank you, Arnold Balais, Captain A.
Thank you po.
Puntahan naman natin si Sir Jeffrey Tarayao. How do we inspire others to act?
I think if the end game here is to be a valuable, successful person, then we can never be truly successful if not all of us are successful. So we always have to think about the others, no? About the growth of others. Hindi lang yung sarili natin. And I think that is what this discussion is teaching us. It's the economics of sharing, diba? Yung pakikipagkapwa-tao at yung pakikibahagi. So I think that's the only way for us to really move forward meaningfully.
Thank you, Jeffrey Taraya, Juan Miralco Foundation, all of our speakers, our panelists. Great, wonderful answers. It's such an honor for me to moderate this plenary. I wasn't expecting this when they asked me to do this. So, Kuya Luis, are you there? Haven't seen you in so long. Kuya Luis, finally, the president of, the chairman of Gawad Kalinga, will close this plenary, this amazing plenary.
Actually, my role is to just thank sila Mikey. Salamat, Ate Mikey. Ate daw. No, but it's these are really friends, no? Bonded and I guess drawn to a calling to make a better future for the Filipino. And I guess the message that cut through me is that to break the barrier is to really, the first step is to believe that things can change. Like what Ms. Pantaho, Arnold, Jeff, and Mikey been talking about, no, that the first step is to really believe. And sadly, most poor family could not see beyond a meal, could not see beyond yung shanties and even in the dark yung ginagawa nila ni Jeff. And this is what this convergence is all about, no? To raise the curiosity, to build better collaboration from these different disciplines, and really, I guess, inspire Filipinos to believe that there is a better future and we can be better, no? If we work together. So maraming salamat sa inyong lahat. And I do hope and pray that God keeps everyone safe and while really working very hard out there. So marami salamat and hope to see you in the front lines. Thank you. Bye-bye. Mikey, Jeff, Arnold, bye-bye. Nina, maraming salamat din.
Kala ko kinalimutan mo na ako eh, Kuya Luis.
Hindi, no? Save best for last. Thank you.
Bye. Thank you for having me.
Again, breakout session 2 starts at 4:30 p.m. We have posted the breakout Zoom links here in the chat box, and you can also find them in your delegate kits and in our Facebook page. In the meantime, we will be having a short intermission. Please enjoy this video of the Tedurais and the Lambangians and their practice of livelihood called the Sulagad system.
Good day. I am Mr. Santos Simonsad, a member of the indigenous peoples belonging to the Tedurai tribe of the province of Maguindanao. I am a deputy tribal chief of our tribe, serving in our indigenous political structure or an ancient governance system of the Tedurai and Lambangian. The video is all about the Tedurai and Lambangian practice of livelihood. We call it Sulagad system.
Noon, yung mga pananim, makikita mo talaga na kahit walang fertilizer, na talagang mataba siya, normal na tanim kung titingnan mo. Sa ngayon, kung magtanim ka, hindi mo na masabi na okay pa dahil sa, yun na nga, wala nang katas yung lupa. Parang doon kami nahihirapan kung paano ba talaga i-maintain yung tinatawag na sulagad. Dati, puro mga malalaking kahoy ang makikita mo. So sa ngayon kundi nakikita mo talaga na talagang kalbo na yung mga lupain.
Do pwede yun okay problema kasi tungkol ba sa hoke ni bidag tao gai blewe ni uni ka iba no man iyo de mdoi mungat na edo ginamit do medisina unay pantade mensira kanlob gitaho.
Yeah, pagpasok ng modernization ngayon, lalong mas yung tao ngayon mas focus sila sa monocropping. Parang ang nakita nila is pera na lang yung ano, na, tapos bago makatanim, imo utang.
Ang pagkukuha ng lupa sa lupain nino ng mga Tedurai at Lambangian ay hindi biglaan. Hindi biglaan. Tinatanong yung mga IP na, yung mga Tedurai at Lambangian, anong kailangan mo para maiangat yung buhay mo doon sa lupa mo? Gusto mo ba ng financial? Gusto mo ba ng seeds o di kaya bene o binhi, no? Para matugunan yung pag sustento mo doon sa lupa mo.
Halimbawa ngayon kasi may mga inintroduce na mga batas na, di ba, yung iba massive yung mga paggamit ng mga synthetic na mga fertilizers. So yung konsepto ng sulagad ay dahan-dahang nawawala.
So kung hindi natin makikita, no, may taguyod yung kanilang mga rights dun sa kanilang lupain nino, ay talagang mahihirapan yung mga kapatid nating Tedurai at Lambangian.
Ang madalas na binabanggit ng mga leaders sa community doon sa pagharap natin ng bagong sistema ngayon, dapat mayroon tayong sulagad na sistema.
Ang sulagad ay ito yung mga sariling produkto o tanim na mga katutubo na makikita mo doon sa kanilang mga lugar, no? Parte rin ng sulagad, no, na sa pagtingin ng IP, yung kung ano yung nakikita ng mga pagkain mismo na nakadepende o galing mismo doon sa environment, no, sa paligid. Tinitingnan dyan yung simula sa mga isda na nakukuha sa mga ilog, no, mga pagkain na galing sa kagubatan, no, katulad ng mga wild na mga pagkain, no. Of course, tinitingnan rin ng tribo na kasama doon sa konsepto ng sulagad yung mga samutsaring mga hayop na inaalagaan, no. Usaping pagkain ito at saka papaano ma-sustain yung maitawid yung buhay ng IP para sa susunod pa niyang mga panahon o sa loob ng isang taon at sa sunod niya pang henerasyon.
So una-una kay daba bananan, bago daba simula gadanan, modor umhisage, daba usaping sula gadanan, mag-ritual gay na. Daan gabalay go ba dasigisu nan tidodo hadian dio lok do bagas sempre minsan sak gabalay go ba bagas sempre uni berhan sulagad sempre mohok tabda hari nan.
Bali de ba sulagad ni kayen to fo 100% for yet itin tu ka getabang de ba familia we de getabang talaga nanti beno sempre ndaga der unta de na to fo fresco sana ho sani i ama ni de.
Alam naman natin na yung sulagad ay ano to, maganda yung maging resulta niya dahil walang kasiraan sa kalikasan yung gustong gawin ng sistemang ito, no. Siguro kung may sa praktika ito ng mga katutubo, maaring sabihin natin maiwasan o mabawasan na yung mga kasiraan na ginagawa doon sa agrikulturang sistema.
Ang sa pag-practice ng sulagad system ay makakatulong doon sa pag-restore ng nasirang lupain.
Nakikita natin na ito yung isa sa mga solusyon para hindi gutumin yung mga katutubo, no, sa kanilang mga komunidad.
Ang isa sa mga initiative natin ngayon, kailangan natin yung dahan-dahan na pagpapaintindi at pagpa-advocate na yung ano ba yung kahalagahan ng sulagad. Pwede nagkaroon yung Dry Lambangian Youth and Student Association ng sulagad farm, parang imodelo na ganito sana yung gagawin natin at pwede nating i-replicate dun sa ibang mga communities.
sa pag-research o pag-patyuntok, no, ng isang kabataang Tidro at Lambangian na nakikita nila at nakikita nila at may paniniwala sila, no, sa sunod na mga panahon, no, maging sila, no, sila yung magpapatuloy, no, magpapatuloy doon sa usaping sistema, lalong-lalong sa usaping sulagad farming.
Kailangan tuloy-tuloy tami sulagad din kasi tidaw paganay nani tanda na rin de Lucas Betom na kohok-kohok nan.
Gagano po man tayo bablewe ni Benny, yung karyad sa kay ba kaluhan na siya ni nga ni bablewe ni. Dapat continue na itinto ka continue ba ni ba siya ni barahan ni sulagad kagoy de nga ni.
Kagne de kan tamu ke keluhanan iyo da sumbergeno ke kreit ke weder migo tabang-tabang.
Thank you everyone for watching this little intermission. So as mentioned, we'll be moving again to the breakout sessions. So we keep on copying the links. I'm going to copy them again in the chat so you guys can just choose the breakout session that you want to join. So there will be four breakout sessions. So on Zero Exclusion, they will be talking about the support system for entrepreneurs, fighting exclusions. Then there will be also a session on Zero Carbon. We will be talking about circular economy. Then we have two sessions on zero poverty. So you can actually choose from one session that will be talking about fishermen and coastal communities. And we have another session which will be talking about fishermen, farmers and agri-based value chain. So those are the four breakout sessions that you can actually choose from. The links are in the chat. So same process, you leave the webinar, you move to the breakout room. It will be starting in exactly 3 minutes at 4:30. And it will be until 5:45. So we'll regroup here at 5:45 in the webinar so we can have some closing remarks and some closing messages together. So again, I want to thank Mikey, Georgie, Captain A, and Jeff with their inspiring, life-changing stories, breaking barriers for themselves, but also for others. And I want to keep that quote in mind. Don't worry, the children are listening to us. Worry that they are always watching us. And I think this is a very powerful quote. So I leave you now. You guys have 3 minutes to jump to the breakout session. I still see about 80 people here. So again, the link are in the chat. Just click on the link, move to the breakout session. You have four different options to choose from. The links are here in the chat, or they're also in your delegate kit. And they've also been posted on Facebook. So we have four super exciting breakout session. I know it's hard to choose one out of the four, but that's how it is. And obviously that would be one way to keep you excited and interested to continue the conversation, to know what has happened in those other breakout session. I'll see you guys at 5:45. See you later.